Hello, I'm Dr. Q. Welcome to my channel. This is the 16th class of Principles of Economics. In this video, I will cover perfect computation in the long run. In lecture 15, we focused on the perfect computation in the short run. We discussed the options firms have in the short run are limited. Individual firm can do nothing but accept the market equilibrium price. The business can choose to produce if market price is decent in making profit or covering fixed cost. But there is no sufficient time for entrepreneurs to establish a new firm in the industry or for a business in different industry to switch and enter this industry. Firms in perfect competition in the short run can also choose to shut down in the sense that it produces zero unit of output when the market price is unfavorably low. But firms do not have enough time to liquidate their assets, sell the property, and go out of business permanently. In the long run, by contrast, firms have adequate of time to expand the business by investing on new capital, installing new production line, doubling the size of factory, or even enter a new industry. In the long run, if the firms are not successful, they also have time to size down their production capacity or firm size. They can also choose to close permanently by liquidating their assets, which is called exit. In the long run, we observe businesses change the production capacity and firm size. We also see existing firms leave or exit an industry, or new firms launch or enter an industry. Please refer to lecture 12 for more discussions in short run and long run. We are here care more about the incentive for firms' adjustments in the long run. In this lecture, firstly, for the convenience of illustration, we just focus on the entry or exit situation as opposed to the adjustments in firm size or production capacity. Besides, in the long run, we ignore any short-run adjustments in economic resources to change output. In the long run, fixed cost and variable cost are not within our consideration. Everything can be adjusted. There is just the total cost. Please refer to lecture 14 for long-run cost curve. Secondly, in lecture 15, I said that there are many similar firms producing identical or the same products in perfect competition. They are not exactly the same, but we're not losing much of information by assuming that they are identical. It's convenient for us to assume all firms in the industry have identical cost curves. So we can use one average or representative firm for analysis and know that all firms in the industry are influenced the same way by any changes in the long run. Lastly, we assume the industry is a constant cost industry, which means firms' entry or exit or any long run adjustment won't influence resource price and therefore won't change firms' average total cost curve. This happens when the industry's demand for a resource is small in relation to the total demand for the resource. For example, in pencil industry, the demand for wood to produce pencils increases if more companies enter the pencil industry. However, because pencil industry only accounts for a small portion of wood demand, the price of timber won't be influenced, at least not significantly. Another example will be the internet storage space. As the users of internet grow, there is an increase in demand for storage space. However, because storage space is relatively large to meet the entire market, storage space costs do not go up. Therefore, the long-run supply curve of a constant cost industry is horizontal or perfectly elastic. I will talk more about this in a few slides. Now, let's focus on the incentive of perfect computation firms' adjustments in the long run. In our setting, it is the incentive for entry and exit. In short, for a perfect computation industry, why do new firms enter sometime and why do existing firms leave in other time? Again, it's all about profit. They are doing so to maximize profit or minimize loss. Let's do a quick review of lecture 15. The right-hand side axis set is for individual firm in perfect computation market. And this is a firm's average total cost curve. Now, as we are switching on to long-run situation, shouldn't we use long-run average total cost curve? That's correct, but it does not matter. Because in lecture 14, we learned that business in the long run will adjust its firm size to minimize the average total cost. Firms produce at an efficient scale. The short-run minimum average total cost is the long-run minimum average total cost. The upward sloping part of a marginal cost curve of a firm crosses average cost at minimum long-run average total cost. Let's assume that the downward sloping demand curve and upward sloping supply curve at this moment happen to intersect at about 1 billion units, 1,000 million is a billion, an equilibrium price of $60, which happens to be the firm's minimum average cost. According to what we learned from lecture 15, this is a demand curve faced by one firm in perfect computation. It's also the average revenue. The money collect out of selling happens to be the costs in producing. Individual firm is at break-even point. This price level is unique because it's not only stable in the short run, it's also stable in the long run. The industry is at rest because incumbent firms do not have tendency to leave. The outsider firms do not have incentive to enter. Incumbent firm refers to a firm that is already in position in the market. Then something happened to market demand. For example, in our coffee example, coffee as a beverage becomes popular in more countries and results in an increase in demand and a market equilibrium price. Market equilibrium changes. At such a high price, the crossing point of price and marginal cost defines optimal output level. At this output level, trace up to average total cost curve to find the corresponding per unit cost. The mint area is the economic profit individual firm can earn thanks for the positive demand shock. This is what we learn in lecture 15. And that's the end of it for short run. In short run, as long as a high demand and a high equilibrium price persists, firm will earn nice and positive economic profit. But this is not true in the long run. Why? Because the persisting economic profit will attract new firms to enter and they are able to do so in the long run. In Lecture 7, we'll learn that as the number of firms within an industry increase, the market supply will also increase and the supply curve shifts right-hand side. Let's look at the graphical expression. The economic profit will lure new firms into the industry. As more firms join the production, the supply gradually increase and push the equilibrium price down. Until when? Until all economic profit is exhausted, which means back to break-even point. We can say compare with the original market equilibrium with the dashed line. The new equilibrium output increases from 1 billion to 3.1 billion, thanks for the entry of new firms. However, equilibrium price does not change. They are both $60, which is the firm's minimum average cost. At this price level, the market again is at rest because it's not profitable for new firms' entry and incumbent firms are not losing money, so they don't want to leave. I want to emphasize that none of those takes place over one night. It's a gradual process for demand change, supply change, and individual firms adapting to new market condition. Now, let's review another time. Although demand changes first and supply changes correspondingly then, I'm here to show the graphical expression of them changing simultaneously so we can better grasp the dynamic. This is the original demand and supply with equilibrium price at firm's minimum average cost. Then demand increase and therefore supply increase. Both move right-hand side. And most importantly, the shift distance in supply matches the shift distance in demand curve. Therefore, at this new equilibrium, price level does not change and it shouldn't change. It's at minimum average cost. It's the output produced by the market increase. In sum, no matter how many units of output the industry has to produce, in the long run, the price it charges the society will always be the amount that happens to compensate firm's minimum average cost. That's why the long-run supply curve for a constant cost-perfect commutation industry is perfectly elastic. It's fixed at a firm's minimum long-run average total cost. Of course, the market demand receives negative shock from time to time. In our coffee bean example, people switch to consuming tea or economic downturn results in lower budget for purchasing coffee. All of those cause decrease in market demand and decline in equilibrium price. At such a low market price, if it's above the shutdown point. Individual firm has to accept it and produce the output quantity when price equals marginal cost. From the optimal output, trace up to the average total cost curve to find the corresponding per unit cost. The red area is economic loss. In the short run, businesses cannot do anything. In the long run, the resulting economic losses will induce firms to leave the industry eventually. And the declining number of firms results in a decrease in supply. Supply curve shifts left-hand side. So the owners of incumbent firms seek a normal profit elsewhere rather than accept economic loss resulting from lower demand. And when they have enough time, the owners close the business permanently. As long as losses continue, more firms leave the industry. An exodus of firms proceeds, supply decrease and shift left-hand side. This gradually pushes the price back up to the level that losses are eliminated so that the remaining firms break even or only make normal profit. That is a firm's minimum long-run average cost. From the market's output level, we can see that the quantity produced declines dramatically from 1 billion to about 150 million. Assuming the optimal output of individual firm is 6. This decrease in demand and therefore a decrease in supply force 140 million firms out. Now, the question is, as we assume all firms have identical cost curves, does it mean that which firms are forced out first is completely random? In real world, the entrepreneurial ability each firm has is different. The ones suffer from incompetent managers or confront other production difficulties will go out of business first. In case I haven't confused you enough with those tangled lines, let me do a summary for situations of short run and long run. In the short run, individual firms' supply is the upward sloping portion of marginal cost curve above shutdown point. In the long run, it has the tendency to produce at its minimum long run average total cost. It's likely that most of the time, firms cannot produce on this point because market changes from time to time. But the entry of new firms or exit of incumbent firms tend to push individual firm back to produce at the minimum long-run average cost. For market, this is the market supply in the short run. Typical upward sloping, just like the supply of individual firm. In the long run, the highlighted red bold horizontal curve fixed at firm's minimum average cost is the supply of the market. To sum up, if the incumbent firms enjoy economic profit because of a favorable market price, then the profit will attract new firms to enter. The entry of firms will increase the short-term market supply, which will push market price downward. On the other hand, if incumbent firms bear economic loss due to unfavorable market condition, in the long run, Some of the firms will close permanently and exit the market. As a result, market supply declines and brings the price up. We have been discussing the constant cost situation. Although it's not the focus of the lecture, I will briefly talk about the increasing cost industry and the decreasing cost industry. Increasing cost industry is fairly common in real world. What does it look like on the market? It happens if market demand increases, resulting in a higher price level for the market. Positive economic profit for firms within. The positive economic profit attracts the entry of new firms, which increases market supply. However, market supply does not shift to the right as much as market demand does. The higher output is associated with a higher price, which results in an upward sloping long-run supply curve. This is more consistent with what we learned in Lecture 7, Law of Supply. Now, let's think about how that happens. The persistent higher market price associated with more firms producing the product is because the average cost of each firm within the industry increases because of the entry. Most of industries are increasing cost industries, in which firms' average total cost curves shift upward as the industry expands and downward as industry contracts. Think about the chocolate example. Chocolate producers use cocoa beans to produce chocolate. Therefore, they are big buyers or consumers of cocoa beans. If more firms enter to produce chocolate, demand for cocoa beans increases, which results in an increase in price of cocoa beans. Cocoa beans become expensive and the cost of chocolate production increases. Average total cost curve shifts upward. Increasing cost happens when the industry accounts for a big or decent portion of resource demand. Other example is mining industry such as petroleum, gas, and coal. Long-term demand growth results in higher prices due to increased energy production costs. Because the industry faces higher production costs, companies will charge higher prices for their output to break even. The last one is decreasing cost industry. For market level, if market demand increases, causing new firms to enter and therefore supply increases. However, supply curve shifts a bigger distance than demand curve does. As a result, a lower price is associated with a higher output level. That's because entries of new firms will lower the average total cost for firms within. In decreasing cost industries, firms' average total cost curves shift downward as industry expands and upward as the industry contracts. I am hesitant to cover this situation because this is inconsistent with the law of supply covered in Lecture 7, and I really don't want to add on more confusion. But there are, not many, but there are some decreasing cost industries. For example, airline companies may do the maintenance of airplanes themselves or outsource to the companies that are professional in airplane maintenance. If demand for airline service increases, airline companies have to increase flight frequencies to satisfy. Then the demand for airplane maintenance goes up as well. When airplane maintenance company service capacity is established, The expanded demand in airplane maintenance enables substantial economies of scale. For example, hypothetically, the monthly cost of operating an airplane maintenance business is $10,000. If the airline companies send 20 airplanes in for service, then the per unit cost is $500. If demand for flight service increase and therefore airlines demand for airplane maintenance service increase and send 40 aircrafts for service, then the per unit cost declines to $250. They may pass this cost saving on to final price consumers pay. On the other hand, these type of industries show increasing cost if output contracts. When demand for flight service declines and if it persists, airlines' demand for aircraft maintenance decreases as well, and there are not enough airplanes serviced to keep the average cost of maintenance low. In perfect competition, efficiency is achieved in the long run. It's true that in short run, individual firm may earn economic profit or bear loss due to the ups and downs of market price. But eventually, the easy entry and exit feature will let the short run market supply curve move to the price level that eliminates any profit or loss. An individual firm is back to break-even point or only makes normal profit. It makes sure that business produce at the least costly way under the prevailing technology and cost conditions. If it does not, it produce at a higher cost level, the firm will go out of business. This is production efficiency. Meanwhile, long-run equilibrium in perfect competition also guarantees allocation efficiency. The price consumers are willing to pay has equal to the extra cost of producing this unit of output. Therefore, society's scarce resources are used to produce the goods or services that people most desire. The triple equality ensures both efficiencies are achieved. We can visualize how perfect competition maximizes the benefit surpluses to consumers and producers. Consumer surplus is the difference between the maximum prices that consumers are willing to pay for a product and the market price of the output. Why is that? Because, for example, at output quantity of 1, how much do consumers are willing to pay? We need to find that on demand curve. At output of 1, consumers are willing to pay this much, about $90. But how much do they end up paying? They end up paying the equilibrium price of $60. The gap in between is the surplus consumers acquire. A sum of all these distances is total consumer surplus. Therefore, consumer surplus, we use CS as the abbreviation. It is the area below demand curve, above equilibrium price, enclosed by the axis set. This triangle is consumer surplus. How do we calculate the consumer surplus? Thanks for the straight demand curve, we don't need to use integral. We just calculate the area of the triangle. It's the base multiply height and the product divide by 2. The base is 2.5 million, while the height is this, which is the distance between 60 and 110, that is 50. So consumer surplus can be calculated as 2.5 million multiplied 50 and then divide by 2, which is 62.5 million. Please be careful about the unit of measurement. Producer surplus is the difference between the minimum prices that producers are willing to accept for a product. As shown by the supply curve and the market price of the product. Again, for example, at output quantity of 1, the producers are willing to accept a price of this much. We can find on supply curve, that is about $30. They actually receive a payment of this much, equilibrium price of 60. The gap in between is the producer surplus. A sum of those gaps is total producer surplus. Therefore, producer surplus, we use PS as the abbreviation. It is the area above supply curve, below equilibrium price, enclosed by exit set. This triangle is producer surplus. The calculation follows the same rationale. The base is output quantity of 2.5 million, while the height is the difference between 60 and 10. The producer surplus is 62.5 million. Here, consumer and producer surplus happen to be the same. In real world, they are very likely not the same. We just focus on the situation that demand changes first, supply changes as a result. In real world, firms' average cost can change because of the resource price or technology advancement. Therefore, supply side changes. In free market economy, consumers want to purchase goods or services to maximize the utility, happiness, or satisfaction with least money, while producers want to do business to maximize their profit. According to the father of economics, Adam Smith, through individual self-interest and freedom of production, as well as consumption, the best interests of society as a whole are fulfilled. The constant interplay of individual pressures on market supply and demand causes the natural movement of prices and the flow of trade. Adam Smith refers as invisible hand, which is metaphor for the unseen forces that move the free market economy. The invisible hand is part of the laissez-faire, meaning let-go approach to the market. In other words, the approach holds that the market will find its equilibrium without government or other interventions forcing it into unnatural patterns. But we all know that the real world is not perfect. Asymmetric information, time lag, irrational behavior, etc., can all be obstacles to achieve equilibrium. And most of the industries do not belong to perfect competition market. Business owners want to maximize profit, but we know for a fact that in perfect competition in the long run, business can only break even unless it can figure out a way to lower its cost or invent a new product that its competitors cannot produce. This is also a great feature in perfect competition that encourages entrepreneurs to be creative and conduct innovation. Through innovation and technology diffusion, new production methods replace old products and production methods, resulting in obsolete machines and structural unemployment. which means the workers used to work on old products lose their job because they are now trained to use new production methods. For example, the newspaper industry is replaced by online source of news. Photographic film is replaced by digital photography. Creation of new products normally comes hand in hand with destruction of old products. In perfect communication, if someone develops new products or technology to earn profit, it's very likely that soon enough everyone else copy and eliminate the profit. In order to protect the incentive for innovation or creation, there is a patent system that grants the inventors at least 20 years of exclusive rights to sell the product. The inventor enjoys 20 years of economic profit as nobody else can produce. The positive economic profit provides it more financial resources to develop new products and to generate more profit. This all sounds enticing, but there's side effect. Newton has said that if I have seen further, it is by standing on the shoulders of giants. Patent system prevents new innovators from using the existing technology and make new innovation progress. For example, for smartphone development, there are thousands of different technologies and therefore patents involved. A single lawsuit filed over just one of those patents could halt the development of the entire product. The established company does so to tax innovators in order to protect their exclusive right in developing and producing in this industry. On top of that, there are patent trolls who invent nothing and produce nothing. They simply buy up patents for the chance to sue other companies and collect royalties. They are the results of the patent system. But on the other hand, for some industries, for example, pharmaceuticals, it easily takes company tons of research and development, decades to develop a new medicine. But once the chemical formula for the drug becomes known, rival firms can make a chemically identical version without going through the tremendous costs, which is not fair. So it is recommended to eliminate patents on complicated, hard-to-copy products, but establish patents on easy-to-copy products. And for pharmaceutical industry, after getting approvals from FDA, it may only have about 5 to 7 years left to produce the drug exclusively. So longer patent time is reasonable for this type of industries. But patent-related technology is less of a topic in perfect competition. After all, coffee cherries farmers have little resource or support to do so. It's something the businesses that have monopoly power would do. In next lecture, I will cover monopoly. Thank you for watching. Please like, share, or save the video, and subscribe my channel for more lectures in economics.